Hello and welcome to Once Upon a Time, brought to you by the Marshall Public Library and Pocatello Community Media. We're so happy to be here with you today. I'm Catherine Poulter and here is
Becca Hyde.
Hello. And we have so many good things to read to you today. It is starting to be a little bit warm outside, but you'll just have to see how all of the books that we chose tie together, if there is a theme or not. The first book that I chose is so beautiful. It's called Hue Boy, and it's by Rita Phillips Mitchell, and the pictures are so beautiful. The pictures are painted by Caroline Binch. Here we go. Hue Boy. Little Hue Boy was big news in his village. He was so small that all his friends towered over him. Every morning, Hue Boy's mama measured him. "Come, I must measure you before you go to school," she said. "Stand straight against the wall." It did not matter how straight Hue Boy stood, he remained the same size. Very small. He didn't grow at all. "Oh, Lord," cried Hue Boy's mama, "I wish your papa was home. He would know what to do about this." But Hue Boy knew his papa was working on a ship far away. Then one day mama said, "Hue Boy, if you want to grow tall, you must eat fresh vegetables and fruit every day." "Like pumpkins?" asked Hue Boy. "I like pumpkin soup." "Pumpkins are good, but what about spinach, Hue Boy?" "Yuck," Hue Boy said. "I don't like spinach, Mama. I'd rather have fruit, like mangoes and melons."
"And pineapples and sopapillas, I suppose," said his Mama.
Yum, yum," said Hue Boy.
How about sweet sops, cashews, and crabboos, his Mama asked.
"Yes," said Hue Boy. "And don't forget guavas or tamarinds either."
"I won't, Hue Boy," said Mama. Hue Boy was soon eating everything his Mama gave him. Pumpkin soup was delicious, but he enjoyed eating fruit best. Still, Hue Boy didn't grow one little bit. He didn't grow at all. On Hue Boy's birthday, Gran gave him a special present.
"I've made you new clothes," she said. "You'll soon grow into them."
Hue Boy tried on the clothes. They felt a little loose.
"Oh, Lily, you look taller already," said Gran.
Then, one morning, neighbor Carlos said, "I know, Hue Boy. Some stretching exercises will do the trick. 10 minutes a day, that's all you need to do." And so Hue Boy began to do all sorts of exercises. He stretched as much as he could. Still, Hue Boy didn't grow one little bit. He didn't grow at all. At school, his classmates chanted, "Heels, heels, high heel shoes, needed for the smallest boy in school." Hue Boy looked down, but Miss Harper, the teacher, said,
"Stuff and nonsense. Just ignore them, Hue Boy. You'll be growing soon enough."
Still, Hue Boy didn't grow one little bit. He didn't grow at all. Mama worried, "I don't like you being teased, Hue Boy." She said, "Come, we must look for some help." First, they went to see the wisest man in the village.
"Please," said Mama, "can't you help Hue Boy to grow like other children?"
The wise man looked at Hue Boy from head to toe, then from toe to head.
"Well, Hue Boy," he said, "where help is not needed, no help can be given."
Next, they visited Dr. Gamas. He examined Hue Boy thoroughly. Then he said, "There is absolutely nothing wrong with you, Hue Boy. Some people are short and perfectly healthy, you know."
"Laddie," cried Mama, "this problem seems to be bigger than this village."
She thought carefully. "We ought to try Miss Frangipani, the healer," she said. "Maybe she can help." Hue Boy sighed.
"I hope so."
"Miss Frangipani," said Mama, "please can you do something for Hue Boy to make him grow?"
"No problem," said Miss Frangipani. "I alone hold the secret to growing."
Miss Frangipani placed a hand on Hue Boy's head and said, "Ooh, ooh, grow, grow, a touch of the hand, a wish of the mind, comes the cure from far away. Ooh, ooh, grow, grow, as you're meant to do."
Then Miss Frangipani gave Hugh Boy a bundle of herbs. "You must have your bath with these," she told him. "Mind you do it every night." For a month, Hugh Boy did everything that he had been told. Still, Hugh Boy didn't grow one little bit. He didn't grow at all. Sometimes Hugh Boy liked to go to the harbor. Here he watched the ships come and go, and he could forget about his size. One day a beautiful big ship came in. "Man, that looks good," thought Hugh Boy. "It's the biggest ship I ever saw." Then he saw a very tall man among the passengers. The tall man walked straight toward him. "Hello, Hugh Boy," he said. "Papa," cried Hugh Boy. His father took Hugh Boy's hand and they walked away from the harbor and into the village. They walked past Miss Frangipani, they walked past Dr. Gamus and the wisest man in the village, they walked past Miss Harper and Carlos, and they walked past Hugh Boy's friends from school. Then they met Gran and Mama. And Hugh Boy, he walked tall with his head held high. He was the happiest boy in the village. And he didn't feel small at all. The end.
Oh.
What a good story.
What a lovely book. Mm-hmm. And it was beautifully illustrated.
I thought so too.
Thank you.
Yes.
I want to start with a book about the wee folk in Ireland.
Oh, a very good choice.
This is a book titled Tim O'Toole and the Wee Folk, an Irish tale told and illustrated by Gerald McDermott. For Maggie and Kate and Maureen. In a little cottage, on a little hill at the end of a little lane in Donegal, lived Tim O'Toole and his wife Kathleen. Tim and Kate were so poor they had not a penny or a potato between them. Their children ate porridge for supper. Even the mice were thin from want of food, and the cat wouldn't bother with chasing the creatures. Their neighbors, who were poor enough themselves, avoided Tim, for they thought he would bring them bad luck. Things went from bad to worse until one day there was not a crumb or a drop left in the house. "Tim O'Toole," said Kate, "I can stand no more of your being poor and you're sitting around bemoaning your fate. You must go out and find work like a decent man and take us out of this poverty." Kathleen kept after him, and next morning Tim set out to see if he could earn some wages. Tim O'Toole traded and traveled the length of the country, knocking at every door, inquiring at every farm, trying to eke out a few coppers for a day's work, but there was no work to be had. Finally, when Tim was tired and hungry and could walk no further, he stopped and lay down to rest in the cool green clover at the side of the road. No sooner had he stretched out than he heard the faint sound of strange music, piping, and lilting voices raised in song and laughter. The strange sounds were coming from a little hollow in the side of the hill. Tim crept up to the hollow and peered over the edge. There below him was a troop of the wee folk, laughing and singing and carrying on. Well, Tim knew for sure his luck had changed, for it is well known that whoever spies the wee folk in the light of day can demand their treasure. Suddenly the music stopped. The little merrymakers were astonished when they looked up and saw Tim peering down at them. "Hand over your gold," bellowed Tim, trying to be fierce, "and you'll come to no harm." "Have mercy on us, Tim O'Toole," begged the leader of the little people. There was a smile on his lips and he tried not to laugh. "You've got us for fair, so well, we'll see that you're richly rewarded." Then there was hurrying and scurrying in the hollow below, and soon the wee folk handed up a little gray goose. "Here you are, Tim, a goose that lays golden eggs. Go home straight away. Tell not a soul. You and your Kate shall never want for more." Tim started for home, carrying the goose and feeling very pleased with himself. Soon darkness overcame him, and he stopped at a farmhouse to ask if he could stay the night. The couple who owned the farm, the Magoons, let him in and sat him down by the fire. Tim began to boast of his great good fortune and the little gray goose that lays golden eggs. That night, while Tim was asleep in the loft, the Magoons decided they could use such a goose as this. Quietly, they exchanged it for their own. Tim was none the wiser for it, and in the morning went happily homeward, carrying the goose he thought would bring him great wealth. When he got home, he put the bird upon the table. "Is this all you've to show for being gone these 3 days?" asked Kathleen. "But, darling, this is no ordinary goose," said Tim. "This one lays golden eggs." Well, the short of it is, they waited a long, long time, and as you might guess, the goose did no such thing. "They've cheated me," howled Tim, and he marched off in a terrible temper to give the little people what for. When he finally reached their hiding place, he was still angry. "Golden eggs, is it?" cried Tim to the wee folk. "That goose you gave me laid no eggs at all." "This is curious indeed," said their startled leader. Then the little man wrinkled his nose and gave a sly smile. "Tim, wait but a moment and we'll make good your reward." There was hurrying and scurrying in the hollow below. A moment later, the wee folk brought forth a fine linen tablecloth and spread it in front of Tim. In the wink of an eye, it was covered with bounteous food and drink, the likes of which had never been seen before. "Take this tablecloth home straight away, Tim O'Toole, and tell not a soul," cautioned the leader of the little ones. "Then you and your darling Kate shall never want for more." Tim walked merrily toward home until darkness came on him. Again, he stayed the night with the Magoons and boasted to them of his newfound fortune. The Magoons thought in good fortune indeed it was. While Tim slept, they slipped away the magic tablecloth and exchanged it for an ordinary one from their very own cupboard. Tim was none the wiser for it when he reached home the next day. "Kathleen, my darling," he said, "we'll never go hungry again." With a flourish, he spread the cloth upon the table. Well, of course, it was empty and produced not a drop or a crumb. Kathleen laughed. Tim went into a rage. "The little heathens," he shouted, and in a flash, Tim was out the door and on the road again. "Stand fast," Tim called down into the little hollow where the wee folk were gathered. "'Tis pleased you are not Tim O'Toole," said the leader. "Could it be that the tablecloth was empty?" All the wee folk were grinning. "Indeed it was, you scoundrel," answered Tim. The wee ones began to chuckle. "And did you go direct home as we told you?" Tim O'Toole admitted that he had twice stayed the night with the Magoons. When they heard this, the little people burst into laughter. "Ha ha! You were a fool to trust the likes of the Magoons," said the leader. "But never mind, Tim. We've just the thing for you." The little people brought up a strange green hat and gave it to Tim. They introduced and instructed him to boast of its magic to the Magoons and to leave the hat where they could find it. "Then we shall see what we shall see," said the wee one. A third time Tim tarried at the Magoons. He proudly displayed the magic hat the wee folk had given him. Then he crawled up into the loft and pretended to sleep. He had but laid his head upon the straw when he heard the Magoons stir below. "I wonder what sort of magic it is," the Magoon said to his wife. Cautiously, he tipped over the hat. Out of the hat jumped 10 tiny men. Each had a little blackthorn club and began to beat the Magoons about the shins and ankles. The couple whooped and hollered and danced around the room, trying to escape the blows of the wee folk. "Lay off, lay off," begged Magoon. "Tell your henchmen to have mercy, O'Toole. Give me my linen tablecloth and my little gray goose, and I'll leave you in peace," said Tim, laughing all the while. The Magoons gave back what they had taken. Tim put on his hat, tucked the little gray goose under one arm, draped the tablecloth over the other arm, and headed for home. When Tim arrived, he spread the tablecloth before Kathleen and set down the goose in the middle of it. The bird honked and laid a golden egg. Then the most delectable eatables and drinkables began magically to appear on the table. "Kathleen, my darling," said Tim, "we are happy at last." Or so Tim thought. Folks from all parts soon heard of the O'Toole's good fortune and crowded in to see the wondrous goose. Their little cottage filled up with neighbors until there was no place left to sit or stand. Everyone helped themselves to the never-ending supply of eatables and drinkables. "I never knew we had so many friends," said Tim, "but I think 'tis time the party was at an end." Tim tipped his hat, and out jumped the 10 tiny men with black thorn clubs, and they beat the shins and ankles of the noisy crowd and chased them out of the house and pursued them down the hill. After that, the cottage was quiet once again. Tim O'Toole and his family were quite comfortable, you might say. They spent many hours in front of the hearth, sipping tea and chatting and thinking kind thoughts of the wee folk. For all I know, Tim and Kate are there still, in a little cottage on a little hill, at the end of a little lane in Donegal. The end.
Oh, what a sweet story. I like that. Now, this next one has more beautiful paintings. And this is based on, they say, a true story. The last of the author's notes said, "Although the sea chest is fictional, and Sanctuary Island, that we'll soon hear about, is a fictional island, there is a true story, a legend about a severe storm in the Atlantic in the mid-1870s that wrecked a vessel off the coast of Southport Island in Maine. According to the story, the Hendrix Headlight lighthouse keeper was unable to do anything for the vessel due to the ferocity of the storm. Afterward, he found a bundle of feather mattresses washed ashore. Inside was a sea chest." And we're going to learn about what was inside the sea chest. So here we go. "The Sea Chest" by Tony Bazeo and illustrated by Mary Grandpre. Already it's beautiful. City lights flicker in the dark like winking fireflies. I hold my Auntie Meta's papery hand. Together we stare at the shiny photo in her lap, touched so often with hope. The edges curl. My heartbeat rushes in an impatient waltz as we watch for the stranger to arrive. While we wait, Auntie Meta remembers her childhood on a rocky Maine island 80 years ago and more. Only child of the lighthouse keeper and his bride, she gazes out the window as she tells me the story. "I was a solitary child alone on Halley's Headlight for all my first 10 years, with just my mama to teach me reading and just my papa to spin stories of the boundless world beyond the rocks of Sanctuary Island. I longed for a time I might not be the only child the craggy island knew. Spring mornings found me scrambling beneath the porch, robbing the brooding hen of her tawny eggs. I circled double yolk days in yellow on the feed calendar above the Davenport. Supply boat days were double blue stars with their promise of news, fellowship, and sugar to sweeten summer tea. When pumpkins burned orange in the only garden plot the rocky island held, first days of homeschool were boxed in red. But when frost grew thick in the window, I huddled all day by the fire, cloaked in Mama's hand-stitched quilts. I left the calendar for warmer days and braided solitary stories. One icy night, howling winds blew towering waves against the shore. My papa worried for all the ships upon the sea, ships in danger of faltering on the rocks and sinking into the stormy deep. And when he spotted such a vessel out beyond his reach, Papa could do no more for the schooner ship nor crew than burn the light behind the Frenzel lens.
In the frozen dark, the wind shrieked as wave upon colossal wave hurled itself against our rocky shore, tossing up a churning foam that battered the parlor windows and trapped the reflection of firelight upon fragile panes. They rattled and banged until I cried and prayed they'd not crack in two, freeing the waves to wash us out to sea. All the long night, Mama and I curled against the fearsome storm, while Papa made the perilous trip to and from the square light tower. We slept not a dream's worth of sleep through all those blustery hours, fretting for the ship we could not see. At dawn, the wind blew itself out and the storm rolled back across a glassy sea. Papa set off to scout the shore and I went walking along as company, hoping for bits of sea glass to fill my windowsill jar. I clung to Papa's hand in the streaky light while we slid down to the farthest rocks. As we drew near the shore, we saw a sodden bundle of eiderdown mattresses tied with a sailor's knot. It lay heaped upon the rocks, washed up from the schooner that the storm must have swallowed in the night. Our eyes locked wide when we heard the tiniest cry from deep inside the padding. I guessed it a kitten and held the wish close to my heart. Squatting beside Papa, I plucked and pulled at the ragged ends of the icy rope. Our fingers were purple without our gloves, our breath painting clouds of white in the morning air. When at last the rope came free, the mattresses unfolded to reveal a leather sea chest. Again I heard the mule, and my heart soared with hope, like the gulls reeling overhead, breaking the morning silence with their hunger. Papa lifted the latch and lid, and I curled my fingers tight. The frozen hinges squeaked their resistance, then slowly opened wide. We stared down not at a squalling kitten, but into the face of a small stranger, more purple than my fingers from her crying and the cold. My heart pushed hard against my ribs as Papa lifted the baby, wrapped only in a quilt, into his arms. My breath caught hard when he tucked her inside my coat. My arms enfolded her as I hummed a cradle song. She waved a note tied to her fragile wrist, and it says, "We commit this child unto the hands of God. May he guide her, Captain and Mrs. Donald Walker." Papa read the note aloud and shook his head. "To think," he said, "these desperate parents loved their baby so much they were willing to cast her upon the sea." Tears rolled down my frozen cheeks as I nestled her close. There upon the rocks, I named her Seaborn, then carried her home to be my sister. That sunbright morning, Mama covered Seaborn's head with kisses as we laid her by the fire, warming her within and without. Through the frosty winter and on into feathery spring, alight with purple vetch and yellow buttercups, my sister slept inside the sea chest until at last she grew too big. Then Papa built a trundle all her own to tuck beneath my own tall bed. I taught her how to gently probe for eggs in the dimness under the porch. We took turns circling double yoke days and made a game of watching for the supply boat from the galley deck. When the pumpkins ripened on the vine in sunburnt autumn, we carried them across the island and baked pumpkin pies with Mama. I taught her reading as she grew, and together we spun stories of the family living safe and sheltered above the rocks of Sanctuary Island. I spent my days and all the years of childhood with her, your great-grandmother, and my only sister, Seaborn. And when I left our island behind to become a bride, she followed me soon to this green mainland. She married and lived close by until we buried her last spring, leaving me an only child again. Aunt Maita grows silent, and now I pause to remember my great-grandmother's whispery voice, sharing her stories of two island girls. But my dancing heart can't be still for long. Tripping wildly, it beats out a waiting rhythm, a waltzing rhythm behind me. Great-grandmother Seaborn, her oldest possession, a cracked and worn sea chest, lined with an eiderdown quilt, waits open on the table for the tiny stranger my mama and papa have gone to fetch from so far across the wide Atlantic to be my sister. And that's the end.
Oh,
what a sweet story.
Beautiful. Mm-hmm. I'm so glad you found that to read.
I know.
Lovely. We are going to read now a book that I have chosen. It's called Mountain Chef: How One Man Lost His Groceries, Changed His Plans, and Helped Cook Up the National Park Service. And this is a true story.
It is.
And in the book it says, when Tai Sing was a boy, many Chinese people in America worked in laundries and restaurants, but Tai Sing had bigger plans, as big as the country he loved. He hiked the mountains with mapmakers, whipping up gourmet meals for them, and his reputation grew as the best trail cook in California. I think we're going to enjoy this a lot. Tai Sing was a frontier baby born high in the mountains in Virginia City, Nevada. Growing up, he breathed crisp Sierra air and scuffed through sagebrush. He learned to write in both English and Chinese. America was a tough place to be Chinese. Bosses paid Chinese workers less than white workers. Townsfolk spat out Chinese names like they'd swallowed river gravel. Most people with Chinese names ended up cooking in restaurants or washing clothes. Tai Sing, though, had American dirt under his fingernails and dreams as big as the country he loved. Cramped shacks weren't for him. He made plans, big plans. He got a job cooking for map makers as they tramped through the mountains, naming peaks. With sky for his ceiling and sequoias for his walls, he stirred silky sauces, broiled succulent steaks, and tossed crisp salads. In his sheet metal oven, he baked sourdough rolls as light as the clouds drifting above the peaks. His reputation grew, the best trail cook in California. In 1915, Tai Sing got his most important job yet. A millionaire named Stephen Mather was trying to convince lawmakers to create a national park service to protect the country's natural wonders. But in the city, the roar of business drowned out his talk of mountains and trees and animals. So Mather invited writers, tycoons, members of Congress, and even a movie star to go camping. He wanted to show his guests the majesty of America's wild places, but he worried. Give a man a poor breakfast, and after he has had a bad night's sleep, and he will not care how fine your scenery is. So he brought the best camping gear that he could find, newfangled air mattresses for soft and dreamy sleep, and he hired the best trail cook around, Tai Sing. Tai Sing planned. He mulled over menus for breakfast, lunch, and dinner for 30 people for 10 days in the wilderness. Lyonnaise potatoes, peaches and cream, frog's legs, English plum pudding with brandy sauce. He bought bags of flour and tins of sardines and bushels of apples and boxes of crackers and sides of beef. He crated grapefruit and cantaloupe. He hired an assistant, Eugene. On the trail, Mather told stories that made his guests laugh. He scrambled up steep peaks to show them the best views. He plunged with them into mountain pools. And he continued, and he counted on Tai Sing to keep everyone comfortable and well fed. Each morning, Tai Sing woke in the shivering dark and whispered instructions to Eugene. They stacked firewood in the cook stoves and fed kindling to trembling flames until the fire burned steady and strong. They watched the edge of the sky turn rosy while they cracked dozens of eggs. As the other campers crawled out of their sleeping bags, Tai Sing packed box lunches and put steaks on to sizzle. He served breakfast as a yellow edge of sun peaked above the horizon. After breakfast, the other campers left to hike to the next campsite. But Tai Sing and Eugene still had work to do. They heated water on the stove and washed the breakfast dishes. They opened the oven doors and stabbed at the ashes to put out the last wisps of flame. Tai Sing mixed a new batch of sourdough. Then it was time to pack. Tai Sing and Eugene swaddled the china plates, tucked them in a box, and strapped the box to a mule. They folded up the long banquet table. When the ovens were cool enough to take apart, they stacked them neatly and tied them to a mule, too. But first Tai Sing snuggled the sourdough box next to the mule's warm hide so the dough would rise during the day and be ready by evening to bake up fresh for dinner. By the time Tai Sing and Eugene trudged off toward the next campsite, the other campers were hours ahead. Tai Sing and Eugene arrived at the new site just in time to assemble the camp stoves and start a cook fire for dinner. While the oven heated, they washed the heavy linen tablecloths in an icy snowmelt stream and spread it brighter than white water foam over the table. They unpacked the fine china plates and folded thick napkins to cradle the silverware. Then Tai Sing began to cook. He assembled sardine hors d'oeuvres, sliced juicy cantaloupe, and squeezed lemons to make tart sweet lemonade. He grilled steaks and venison, fried fish and chicken, and baked sourdough rolls. He served up gourmet meals as fine as any you'd find in San Francisco restaurants. Tai Sing knew how to plan. One morning, Tai Sing got a head start on the day by packing his gourmet food before the other campers got up. He strapped it to a mule and then tied the mule in the meadow, where it could munch green grass and purple lupine. He dashed back to the stove to fry another egg and dish up more potatoes. Finally, the last camper laid down his napkin and Tai Sing and Eugene could start the breakfast dishes. That's when Tai Sing realized that the mule in the meadow had wandered away with all of the fanciest food on its back. Mather organized the campers to help search. They zigzagged along the river. They crisscrossed the meadow. The mule had disappeared. Mather shrugged and set off on the day's hike. But Tai Sing was so mad he nearly cried. What a disaster! His carefully planned menus were ruined. All that day, while he plodded past boulders and wound through sagebrush, he cataloged the food that he still had left and dreamed up new menus. He changed his plans. That night, there were no fancy hors d'oeuvres. The food was plain, but the chicken was moist, the gravy velvety, and those sourdough rolls were so light they almost floated up to join the clouds. For dessert, Tai Sing baked an all-American apple pie. Mather and the other campers sighed happily as they pushed away from the table. They gathered around the blazing campfire and talked about the stunning scenery they'd seen. They told ghost stories. They made plans for convincing Congress to create a National Park Service. After the campers headed off the next day, Tai Sing tied the mule's ropes with extra care. He didn't want another mule wandering away. The trail along Rattlesnake Creek was narrow and steep. Tai Sing stepped carefully, loose rock shifting and crunching underfoot. He took it slow, but one mule drifted too close to the edge. Clatter, clang, crash! The mule tumbled off the trail and down the cliff. Boxes burst and bags flew open. Utensils and food flew through the air. At the bottom, the mule shook itself and scrambled back up. It was fine, but the food and the gear were not fine. And at 9 that night, Tai Sing stumbled into camp with the battered boxes and bent knives and bruised apples he'd salvaged. His sourdough was lost, somewhere in the dusty gravel at the bottom of the cliff. No more rolls as light as clouds. Mather and the other campers had been waiting for hours. They were ravenous. What could Tai Tsing feed them? He had to make a new plan, and fast. The food would be simple. Tai Tsing could make. He could make. Sure, the setting was elegant, though. He and Eugene laid china on the linen tablecloth and strung paper lanterns above the table. They stewed those battered apples and baked flat but scrumptious biscuits. That night, the campers ate the best applesauce they'd ever tasted. They ate well the entire trip, but Tai Tsing dreamed of more than stuffing hungry bellies. Stephen Mather wasn't the only one who loved the mountains. Tai Tsing had the Sierra singing in his blood. He too planned to fill the campers with memories. The last night, for the first time, he didn't hover over the cooking pots. They bubbled on the stove while he bent over tiny slips of paper and he wrote in English and Chinese. After dinner, Tai Tsing served fortune cookies, a handwritten message tucked inside each one. Here's some of the messages. Long may you search the mountains. Long may you build the paths through the mountains. Where but in the mountains would such a man become a spirit with the mountains? The campers read their fortunes and grinned. They would remember the crackle of the campfire and the slant of the morning sun across the trail. They would remember dining around the linen tablecloth under the trees. In the months that followed, they wrote magazine articles, published books, and made movies about America's national parks. On August 25th, 1916, exactly 1 year, 1 month, and 1 day after Tai Tsing served his fortune cookies, Congress created the National Park Service. On that day, Tai Tsing was on the trail, cooking up more than mountain magic. Today, if you visit Yosemite National Park, you can hike to Tsing Peak. It was named for Tai Tsing, a mountain-loving American who knew how to plan. And here's an actual photograph of Tai Tsing.
Oh, cool.
On a camping trail, and here he is with his cooking stove. And here's the linen tablecloth with all of the campers.
Oh, that's great.
Oh, I love that.
Oh, that is a good story. Well, my next one also has beautiful pictures. Mm. And this is an original fairy tale or story, anyway, by Laura Krause Milmed, and it's illustrated by Henry Sorensen. It's called Prince Nautilus. Prince Nautilus. In a weathered shack by a windswept shore, two poor girls lived with their father. The older sister, named Columbine, was a great beauty, but her heart was as cold as kelp. Mm. Though the girl's mother had died years before, Columbine never lifted a finger to help at home. Instead, she gossiped in the village or preened before her looking glass, yearning for a wealthy husband who would shower her with gold and jewels. The younger sister, Fiona, was kind and capable. Each day she swept the floor spotless. Each night she had the stew pot bubbling when her father returned with his fishing nets. After her morning chores were done, Fiona walked by the edge of the sea, her hair whipping wild in the wind. She gazed out at the horizon, imagining what lay beyond it. One day, as Fiona stood daydreaming, a large seashell washed onto the shore. The perfect milk-white spiral filled her hands, its lip glowing as pink as dawn. She raised it to her ear to hear the echo of the sea. Instead, she heard a voice crying, help me, please. Alarmed, Fiona dropped the shell, then knelt on the sand beside it. Who are you? She whispered. I am Prince Nautilus, the voice replied. An evil sorcerer has shrunk me to the size of a minnow and trapped me in this shell. Here I've lived, tossed by wind and waves, until a lucky tide washed me to your feet. Please, help me to break the evil spell and return to my father's kingdom."
Fiona ran home. "Listen," she cried, and held the shell to Columbine's ear. When Prince Nautilus had repeated his tale, the sisters exclaimed, "We will help you." But though Fiona spoke from the goodness of her heart, Columbine had her own plans. When the prince was free, she thought, he would not be able to resist her beauty. Someday, she might be queen. Prince Nautilus said that at daybreak he would guide the sisters to a magic isle where the spell could be broken. The next morning, Fiona filled a jug with fresh water and wrapped 2 oat cakes. For good luck, she tucked her mother's precious lace handkerchief into her pocket. The sisters carried the seashell to the end of the jetty. There, at the prince's urging, they called out 3 times, "Swan of the sea, hurry to me!" Instantly, a battered old dory appeared before them. "Climb aboard," said the prince. "Swan of the sea will point the way while you row. The spell must be broken before nightfall, when the magic isle slips beneath the sea." Fiona took up the oars, rowing with all her might. As the boat followed the rising sun, flashes of colored light skipped over the swells. Soon, hundreds of little rainbow-striped fish leapt and frolicked around the dory. "How beautiful you are," murmured Fiona. Suddenly, a jet of murky water shot sky-high, then fell back to reveal a huge fish. Its whiskery face was encrusted with barnacles. Its mouth glittered with row upon row of sharp yellow teeth, which it gnashed with an awful grinding sound as it plowed toward the rainbow fish. "Row faster!" shrieked Columbine. Instead, Fiona quickly emptied her jug, then refilled it with seawater, letting the rainbow fish rush in to safety. Somehow, hundreds seemed to fit. As the monster reached the boat, the last little fish wriggled into the jug. The creature plunged beneath the surface with a loud slap of its tail. "How dare you, Fiona!" yelled Columbine. "You've wasted our drinking water. Pour those stupid fish back at once." Fiona held the jug close. Columbine grabbed the oars and rowed angrily. Suddenly, shrill cries rang out overhead where 2 seabirds battled in a flurry of beating wings. One bird, larger than the other, was trying to pull a herring from the smaller one's mouth. With a piercing squawk, the attacker jabbed viciously, then snatched the prize. The injured bird fell into the dory. Fiona quickly bound the lace handkerchief around the bird's blood-stained wing. "Get rid of it!" cried Columbine, and she lifted an oar to frighten the bird away. But at that moment, a pale pink mist appeared in the distance. "Prince Nautilus, I see a mountain," exclaimed Columbine, dropping the oar overboard in surprise. "That is the magic isle," said Nautilus. "We must get there before sunset." But with only 1 oar, the sisters could not row forward. Swan of the Sea could only turn round and round in circles. "We're stranded," cried Columbine. "We'll die of thirst." With a little pop, 1 rainbow fish jumped from the mouth of the jug into the sea. Out leapt another and another and another. The fish laid themselves head to tail, forming a bridge to the island. And a silvery chorus sang out, "Walk on our backs, Fiona." "Thank you," said Fiona, "but Columbine must come with me." Then, taking her sister by the hand, she led her over the sparkling rainbow bridge. Behind them, the seabird flew off as Swan of the Wind disappeared. When they reached the shore, Prince Nautilus said, "On the far side of the island lies a bottle green lagoon. If we reach it before sunset, we can break the sorcerer's spell forever." As the prince spoke, a sad wail rose up over the rocky beach. From behind the boulders came a mournful song. "Oh, woe is me, woe is me! I long to swim the salty sea, to ride the waves, to rock to sleep, cradled in the inky deep.
Oh, woe is me, oh, woe is me. The sea shall see no more of me.
Fiona ran to the rocks. There lay a giant sea turtle, its eyes glistening with tears. One leathery flipper was wedged between two stones. Though Fiona pushed and pulled until her arms ached, the heavy boulders would not budge.
Hurry up, Fiona, Columbine called.
Fiona remembered the prince's warning. We must go, Turtle. I hope this bit of food gives you strength to pull free. She crumbled an oat cake on the sand. The turtle nibbled feebly.
What about me? Whined Columbine. She grabbed the second oat cake and gobbled it up.
Fiona said nothing but set off along the ragged coast. Columbine dragged behind, complaining with every step. The slippery rocks seemed endless, and the girls soon grew exhausted. Columbine sat down, refusing to go further. Fiona sank to her knees. Tears rolled from her eyes. As they slid into the sea, a great hulking shape lumbered from the surf. It was the turtle.
Kind girl, your food gave me strength to free myself. Climb onto my back and I'll carry you to the lagoon.
Fiona was grateful, but once again she refused to leave Columbine, so the turtle carried both of them to a sparkling green inlet, nestled in a curve of golden sand, like an emerald in a royal crown. The sun is sinking, cried Fiona, scrambling down from the turtle. Quick, said Prince Nautilus, throw the shell into the water as far as you can. Columbine snatched the shell and tossed it out. It fell close to shore and returned with the next wave. Then Fiona, with an arm toughened by years of scrubbing and hauling, heaved the shell to the center of the lagoon. It sank for a moment and then bobbed up. The water began to churn and bubble. A foaming geyser erupted, spewing out the monstrous fish. With an awful roar, the creature opened its dripping jaws to crunch the shell between its jagged teeth. The girls cried out. Then the seabird appeared, holding the handkerchief, the lace again as bright as new snow. Flying above the terrible creature, the bird dropped the bit of cloth down onto its back. Instantly, the handkerchief spread into a huge net, entangling the scaly beast. Though it thrashed and twisted, lashing its powerful body from side to side, the more it struggled, the tighter the net drew. As the setting sun touched the water, the monster fish stilled and sank beneath the surface of the lagoon. The water returned to its former calm. The sisters, straining to catch a glimpse of the shell, jumped at the sound of footsteps behind them. They turned to see a young man approaching, the seashell in his hand.
Prince Nautilus, cried Columbine, smoothing her hair.
The prince bowed to her handsomely, then turned to Fiona. Locked in his lonely prison, he had fallen in love with the brave and generous girl. He took her hand and asked her to marry him. Fiona smiled and spoke softly. Prince Nautilus, I cannot marry you now. For years I have longed to see the wide world and its wonders. After this taste of adventure, I am hungry for more. No sooner had she said this than Swan of the Sea appeared. Before their eyes, the dory was transformed into a magnificent sailing ship. The little rainbow fish became a crew of hardy sailors, the turtle a fit ship's captain, and the seabird a fine first mate. They sailed home, where Fiona embraced her father and took him aboard the ship. Kind Prince Nautilus invited Columbine to come as well, but that night as they lay anchored, Columbine stole away with a sack of the ship's gold, and they never saw her again. The next morning at sunrise, Swan of the Sea carried Prince Nautilus, Fiona, the old fisherman, and their loyal crew away toward the shining horizon. In search of bold adventure, the little group set sail, and what they found would quite astound, but that's another tale. The end.
It was beautifully illustrated.
Yes. Indeed.
Well, let's have another tell, a fairy tale, about a kindly giant boy and some wee fairies who like music quite a lot. This is a bit of a classic here by Arnold Lobel. It's titled Giant John. Long ago, in an enchanted forest, there lived a large giant named John. The fairies, who also lived in the forest, played magic and music and danced for John. He had to dance and dance, and he could not stop until the music stopped. The dancing made John's big feet hurt, but he thought it was great fun. In the evening, he would pick a bouquet of trees and take it home to his mother. One night, his mother began to cry. "We are poor," sobbed Mrs. Giant. "There are only 2 potato chips in the cupboard, and we have no money to buy more food." After they ate the potato chips, John said, "Do not cry, Mother. Soon we will have some money. I will go out into the world to find a job." Mrs. Giant made John wear his rubber shoes and carry his umbrella. "Goodbye, Mother," said John as he started on his journey. John walked very far out into the world. He saw mountains and tigers and thunderstorms. He saw a beautiful castle. "Look, look," cried the king and queen and princess and dog who lived in the castle. "Here comes a giant." "Hello," called John. "I am looking for a job." "Stay a while and work for us," said the king. John liked the king and queen and princess and dog, and he decided to stay and went right to work. When it rained, he kept the castle dry. And when it was sunny, he blew a pleasant breeze. He helped the queen do the laundry. He played horsey to make the dog and princess laugh. He cleaned and dusted the castle every day. The king and queen and princess and dog were very happy. They did not even mind when John's snoring kept them awake at night. On Saturday, the king gave John a big bag of gold for all the work he had done. "We'll have a picnic lunch before you go home," said the queen. Suddenly, a cloud of fairies appeared. They were John's friends from the enchanted forest. "We missed you, Giant John," they said. "There is no one to dance to our magic music. We came to play for you." The fairies began to play the magic dancing music. John began to dance. "Ouch," said the king and queen and princess and dog as they fell to the ground. "Stop, stop," shouted John. But the fairies kept playing their music, and John danced and danced. John could not stop dancing. He danced everywhere. He danced on the flowers and on the dog's tail. He danced on the castle. "You foolish fairies," cried John. "Stop that terrible music." The fairies did stop their music. They saw what they had done, and they were very sorry. The king and queen and princess and dog were all crying. But Giant John did not cry. He began to put the castle back together again. The fairies helped too. They bandaged the flowers and the dog's tail. John soon worked hard, and soon the castle was fixed. It did not look quite the same as before, but the king and queen and princess and dog dried their eyes and thought it was beautiful. "Now I must go home," said John, putting on his rubber shoes and hat. He promised to visit often and kissed the king and the queen and the princess and the dog goodbye. John rushed home to his mother with the bag of gold. "Look, Mother," he called, "I have earned some money for us." By this time, Mrs. Giant was very, very hungry. She was glad to see John and his bag of gold coming through the door. That night, John and his mother invited the fairies to dinner. They did not dance, but they ate baked beans and sang many songs, and they lived happily ever after. The end.
What a good story. And that was a very nice one to end with. We have had a great time reading stories to you, and there's still so many more at the library that you can come and check out. So please do. We'll be waiting for you. Goodbye.
Goodbye.